Over the last decade, the EV market has exploded. Experts believe that EVs could hit between 60 and 70% of the market by 2040. But as EV demand grows, so does the question about the efficiency of the EV supply chain and concerns about e-waste. Sure, there's recycling, but not all recycling methods are created equal. However, two companies, American Manganese and Li-Cycle, may have found a solution that is cheaper and cleaner than other recycling methods. Best of all, it could actually bring down the cost of EV ownership. So what's the method? How does it work? And will it really make a big impact? We thought those questions deserve a deeper dive here on 2-Bit da Vinci. Special thanks to Magic Spoon for sponsoring this video. Ditch the sugar and the gluten and keep the cereal with Magic Spoon. Is it delicious? Right now, when it comes to lifetime emissions, EVs have a huge lead over internal combustion engine cars. But there's one area where they actually fall behind. The supply chain for producing EVs has some question marks in it. The process of mining, refining, and manufacturing battery cells requires a ton of energy. And it often takes place in global regions that are not always the most stable politically or financially. On top of that, from start to finish, these materials can rack up some mileage, roughly 20,000 nautical miles to be exact. That's nearly the entire circumference of the Earth. Companies like Audi, Jaguar, and Mercedes have already had to either slow down or completely halt electric vehicle production in the past year due to supply chain bottlenecking. And each of these steps, well, there comes a price, impacting both the environment and your pocketbook. When it comes to the cost of your electric vehicle, the battery alone can contribute up to 30% of the total price, with between 50 and 70% of the battery cost deriving from natural materials. And that's all before the vehicle hits the road. Then there's the second question of where do all these batteries go once they're finished? Their toxic and flammable components obviously can't just go into landfills. Of course, each of these concerns is mitigated by the fact that EVs produce next to no emissions during their lifetime. But with the market expected to grow as it is, there is a real concern that deserves to be addressed. And that's exactly what companies like American Manganese and Li-Cycle hope to do with their emerging lithium-ion recycling methods.
So Li-Cycle is a lithium-ion battery recycling company, and we have a patented technology and a sustainable process for recovering the critical metals and materials from all types of lithium-ion batteries. And my role at the company is the chief technical officer. I'm responsible for our research and development work, our intellectual property portfolio as that continues to grow, as well as commercialization of our technologies, and specifically our hub technology.
Hey, 2-Bit da Vinci viewers. My name is Jarko Meselja, and I'm the CTO and director of American Manganese. And we are working on developing our recyclable process for lithium-ion battery cathode recycling. So I'm just here to talk about the potential there is in recycling lithium-ion batteries, because I think there is still some disbelief in that, and to show that there is, you know, companies with advanced processes that have the capability of recovering these materials and reusing them in lithium-ion batteries.
I had an early dinner, kind of hungry. Lucky for us, our sponsor today is Magic Spoon. I have always loved cereal. It reminds me of Saturday mornings and cartoons. It's such an easy meal, and for my wife and I, a guilty pleasure and a common midnight snack. Magic Spoon is in so many ways the answer. It has 0 grams of sugar, 14 grams of protein, and only 4 net grams of carbs in each serving. Also only 140 calories. Magic Spoon actually tastes great. I wouldn't say it tastes exactly like sugary cereals I've sworn off, but because I know what's in it, I enjoy eating it way more. I got Magic Spoon's best-selling flavors in a 4-flavor variety pack featuring cocoa, fruity, frosted, and peanut butter. It's keto-friendly, gluten-free, grain-free, soy-free, and low-carb. I was pretty surprised to learn that even my son likes it.
Magic Spoon's the best.
You like it that? You really like it that much? That yummy, huh? He hasn't stopped even since we started this thing. Let's just say he didn't like any of the other healthy cereals I've tried over the years. Click the link below to grab a variety pack and try it today. And be sure to use the promo code 2BitDaVinci at checkout to get $5 off your order. Or go to magicspoon.com/2BitDaVinci. Huge thanks to Magic Spoon and all of you for supporting the show. The key to both of these companies is their application of a battery recycling method known as hydrometallurgy. Now that's a big sciencey sounding word, but it just means breaking down metal components using water. The process starts by taking a used battery and shredding it, basically stripping it down to smaller, more manageable pieces. From there, the shredded battery goes through a leaching process where they're exposed to various liquid solvents, chemical precipitates, and electrolysis to separate out the various elements inside the battery.
If you get that material into solution, then the next step is really commonly used solvent extraction. And with solvent extraction, then you need to add one solvent to extract nickel. And then that solvent will bind with the nickel and pull it out. Then you also have a solvent with cobalt and then manganese. And then those solvents also need to be washed off.
Why does this process matter? Well, remember, the goal of recycling is to maximize raw materials while hoping to reduce overall emissions. If we compare this method to other common battery recycling methods, we can begin to understand its benefits more clearly. Another more common method of recycling batteries is sort of the polar opposite of hydrometallurgy. It's pyrometallurgy, or sometimes called thermometallurgy. And as you guessed it, yes, it requires fire to break up batteries down into their components. Basically, you put the batteries in high temperature furnaces, we're talking about 1500 degrees Celsius, where the heat reduces the chemical components, copper, cobalt, nickel, into molten metals in the form of what's known as slag. That slag then gets sent to the refineries for further processing and recycling. Already, I'm sure you could point out a few key issues. First, just by using fire, pyrometallurgy requires far more energy input upfront, which means some form of fuel to burn. Whereas with hydro, you can operate at far lower temperatures.
They're unique in that we process batteries in a wet shredding arrangement. And what that means is we take off-the-shelf equipment that you can buy from suppliers and we modify it to suit our needs. By shredding underwater, we have a natural heat sink in water. It's a very good conductor of heat. And when you're deconstructing or shredding a lithium-ion battery, there's always the potential for energy release. And I mentioned that we can intake batteries in any state of charge. And what that means, again, is that if we're shredding a charged battery, a partially charged battery, all that energy that's released goes into the water phase. And as a result, we see a small increase in the water temperature of our water circuit in the hub. And that's a good indication that we're doing exactly what we want. We're dissipating that energy and we're processing these batteries in a very safe and efficient way.
Li-Cycle, for instance, keeps everything at about an operating temperature of 230 degrees Fahrenheit and only for the final stage of drying their main product. That aspect alone means less energy required. Remember what Smokey the Bear used to say? Well, where there's smoke, there's fire. Well, that's true with pyrometallurgy as well. Burning the battery materials can produce toxic dioxins and sulfides, which all must be recovered to abate pollution. To do that requires bulky, expensive equipment. Hydro generates no air emissions. And as far as their water treatment, Li-Cycle reagents are all fully recycled, meaning they have no discharge from their refining facilities, keeping water emissions to an absolute minimum.
So those are some of the challenges. Like, if you really get into like some of the nitty gritty on the hydrometallurgy, like contamination of water, water balance, material balance, those can all be major differences with just what chemical you're using to leach or extract or precipitate, whatever you want to do there.
Perhaps the most egregious aspect of pyro is that it's not even particularly effective, recovering only a small amount of useful materials, then needing to ship that off to secondary facilities for further extraction.
When you do it thermally, that's when you start to burn off the combustibles, things like plastics, the separators within the cells themselves. And in our process, in the spoke facilities, we don't do that. And because of that, we recover up to 95% of the materials in the batteries that come to us.
Both Li-Cycle and American Manganese boast between 95 and 99% extraction of precious materials, all while generating significantly fewer emissions. Best of all, the process is significantly less expensive. Because smelting facilities require so much space, they also need much more capital investment. Hydro facilities like Li-Cycle and American Manganese can operate at much smaller scales, with more units able to add on as their need arises. And it's also smaller scale accessibility that really allows these two companies to address some of the larger issues in the current battery supply chain. For Li-Cycle, their plan is to introduce a spoke and hub model. Smaller spoke facilities would be strategically placed in areas with high demand for lithium-ion batteries. This could include urban centers or even co-locate with battery manufacturing plants. Spoke facilities are where the battery shredding takes place. From there, the black mass, as it's called, would be moved to the hub facilities for treatment and refining back into those precious battery materials. American Manganese has similar goals of placing their refining facilities in or in proximity to battery manufacturing facilities. Often in battery manufacturing, you have imperfections, materials that are labeled off-spec for whatever reason, which typically has to be disposed of as waste, or placed into an old-school recycling supply chain that we laid out above. Believe it or not, the average battery plant can scrap between 6 and 9% of all the batteries they make. So nearly 10% of all their batteries are actually need to be turned right back around and scrapped and rebuilt. Shouldn't we put maybe more thought into the early life cycle of the battery design choice and chemistry? Every company has their own thing, and companies like Li-Cycle have the difficult challenge of handling every format and style and chemistry, and we never really get to a standard. What do you think will happen?
I think you'll start to see standardization around some chemistries, and you're starting to see that with the shift to nickel chemistries and LFP, for example. We haven't touched on LFP, but Li-Cycle, we do have a sub technology within our hub family that processes LFP and recovers lithium carbonate from LFP batteries. So we're already looking to the future and to understand where the industry is trending towards. Whether there's a standardized factor, I think that's where Li-Cycle has an advantage, in that we can accept any type, any form factor, any chemistry. So we've really tried to future-proof our technology and our business so that we can continue to work with whatever form factors or whatever the industry starts to move towards. Again, I touched on LFP. There's some specific chemistry that we've worked on there to make sure that our process works. And again, we're trying to future-proof our business and our technology to make sure that whatever the trends in the industry might be, we can easily adapt, or we have something that we're already working with that that can intake and process those batteries and get those materials back into the supply chain. That's our ultimate goal.
So this on-site recycling is hugely advantageous. But if battery manufacturers had refining capabilities provided by American Manganese, they could take some of those off-spec materials and process them right back on the spot to have them ready to go directly back into the production line.
My objective is that we want to partner with those that are manufacturing batteries, those on the front end as well as on the back end with the end of life batteries. And our objective is to take that material and to pre-process it, to recover the critical materials in it, and to get them back into the supply chain as quickly as we possibly can.
The company has already begun a pilot plant with a capacity of 500 kilograms per day of cathode waste materials. According to the company's website, the plant is already achieving 99.7% extraction of lithium, nickel, manganese, and cobalt with continuous operation. Both companies' methods effectively eliminate the messy, convoluted supply chain process. Now, a battery manufacturer, let's say, somewhere in the EU, wouldn't have to go all the way back to the beginning of the mining stage, nor would they need to have shipped materials from China. Instead, they could access raw battery materials right in their own neighborhood or possibly in their own factory. And for every ounce of raw material that is recycled instead of mined, has the opportunity to significantly save on cost and the shipping and refining stages all along the way.
We need to stop looking at batteries as a waste that needs to be recycled at the end, but more of a resource that can be recovered instead of going back to mining.
This kind of processing and refining has earned the term urban mining, as it essentially finds those valuable materials in local urban areas rather than extracting them from the earth. With efforts like these made by these two companies and many more, we could help ease some of the pressure of the current supply of raw materials, also while reducing the overall footprint of battery production. One study even estimates that roughly 65% of the cobalt necessary to satisfy vehicle demand in the US could be achieved by lithium-ion battery recycling. And best of all, it could even help bring down the cost of electric vehicles and make them even more accessible. Some experts suggest that substituting virgin materials with recycled materials could reduce the total package price by up to 30%. For example, a 70 kilowatt hour Tesla Model S battery pack weighs about 544 kilograms using an NCA formulation with the approximate ratios, 80% nickel, 50% cobalt, and 5% aluminum, and about 63 kilograms of lithium in total. These battery packs range in price between $12,000 and $13,000. Being able to use recycled materials could theoretically bring the price of a Tesla battery pack down from $13,000 to just under $10,000. I've often joked that nothing turns gas and coal-burning folks into environmentalists faster than talking about the environmental impact of manufacturing solar panels or mining for battery materials. Now, clearly, solar panels can work for decades and EVs for hundreds of thousands of miles, unlike burning coal or gasoline for an instant of use. But as good stewards of the environment and our future generations, it is paramount that we begin thinking about a closed-loop system for our future energy and transportation needs.
To get now into our closed-loop upcycling process is, you know, when we go back to talking about the scrap material coming from manufacturing waste, and the first step really is to separate that material from the essentially the black material from the aluminum foil, and that's done through a leaching step. And this is where, you know, we have our core patent in this leaching process. But essentially, after we create what you see here in the third picture, which is called the pregnant leach solution, and that has all of your lithium, nickel, manganese, cobalt, and plus some impurities as well, and that gets cleaned out prior to the last image here, where we've actually acquired a precipitation reactor used in the cathode manufacturing industry, and this will directly produce cathode precursor material to a certain composition.
We also do get a variety of other products from our hub that will then also be sold back into the broader economy. So we're really trying to close that loop and make our process as sustainable as possible and really reduce the energy profile, if you will, when compared to other technologies that do similar things with black mass.
Imagine being able to recycle all of our batteries after decades of use, than to just turn them back around for another life in a brand new cell. This isn't some sci-fi future. This is happening now. Huge thanks to Li-Cycle and American Manganese for chatting with us. We never figured out how to make a closed-loop clean system for gasoline cars and coal power. But finally, we have a chance now, very early in the adoption of lithium-ion batteries. The future couldn't be brighter. But as always, we want to hear from you. Could hydrometallurgical recycling help close the loop of battery production? What other methods do you know that might be a better alternative? Let us know in the comments below. So that is a look at the future of battery recycling. We just touched on two companies. There are so many more that are in this space. And again, I've always said economics will drive this demand. We have tons of cars, and as more EVs are out on the road, there's gonna be more demand for battery recycling. So there'll be an economic reason to do so. So we're gonna be in really good shape. Don't be surprised if in the future, batteries just go through a loop. They get used for a decade or two, come back in, get scrapped, recycled, and get back out there into cars or planes or houses or whatever else. Really, really awesome stuff. All right, that does it for us. Thank you so much for watching. As always, big thank you to all of you for watching. If you want to be a rock star supporter of the show, consider becoming a patron on Patreon or a YouTube channel member. We call you guys the 2-Bit Tribe. Come chat with us on Discord, help us write scripts, come out on trips with us, all that cool stuff. All for a small monthly subscription. So take a look around the channel. There's some other videos that we think you're going to love. I'm Ricky with Two Bit da Vinci, and just remember, the future is going to be awesome.